So welcome everyone for this session on the very important topic of the neuroanatomy, and that is cerebellum. This cerebellum mainly is involved in balance. Okay, mainly involved in balance, fine movements of the body, muscular coordination. It is the part of the hindbrain, and it is located in the posterior cranial fossa. It is located in the posterior cranial fossa, and it is separated from the cerebrum by tentorium cerebelli. So the cerebrum is somewhat like this. Then here is tentorium cerebelli, and below here is the cerebellum. Below here is the cerebellum. So this is cerebrum. And below that is cerebellum, and the brainstem will be there like this. So this will be brainstem. So this is cerebellum. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw a picture of cerebellum by taking a cut like this, so that this surface, which is called as superior surface, cerebellum, this surface is called as inferior surface of the cerebellum. Now I am getting both the superior and inferior surfaces together. Then there are, like cerebrum, cerebrum had two lobes connected to each other by corpus callosum. The cerebellum also has two lobes which are connected to each other, and that they are connected to each other by vermis. So now what I am doing is I am drawing the cerebellum for all of you. And here what I'm going to draw is, this is one lobe of the cerebellum, and this is the another lobe of the cerebellum, and they are connected to each other by a midline structure, like there was a midline structure, corpus callosum connecting to cerebral hemispheres. This midline structure is called as vermis. Now what has happened is, this cerebellum, what I have drawn for all of you, you need to understand its orientation. Suppose cerebellum was like this. So I have cut it open like this. So the part here, suppose this is the horizontal lobe. So above this part is superior lobe, and below this part is inferior. So the cerebellum was like this, and I have opened it. I opened it in such a way that superior lobe is this part, and inferior lobe is this part. Okay, so I have cut it open through the horizontal section, so that superior lobe and inferior lobe, and this is the horizontal fissure. This part in between is called as vermis. This vermis extends beyond. This vermis extends beyond the two cerebelli, and on each side there is a loculus. Okay, loculus. So now we have two cerebral hemispheres connected to each other by vermis. This vermis is not visible on the superior surface, but inferior surface it is visible. Now this vermis has some parts. This anterior most part is called as lingula. Then there is one more part. There is central lobule. Then there is culmen. Then there is declive. Then there is pollium. So lingula, central lobule, culmen, declive, pollium. Then there are few more structures, and they are tuber pyramid eula and last is nodule. So I used to remember LCD fakes the present United Nations. LCD fakes the present United Nations. Then correspondingly, the cerebellum has parts in its lateral part also. Okay, so these are the parts of the vermis. But then each lobe also shows some parts. This part is called ala. This part is called as quadrangular lobule, quadrangular lobe. Then this is called as simple lobe. Then this is called as superior semilunar lobe. Then below here is inferior semilunar lobe. Then here is biventral lobe. And this part is called as tonsil. And this part is locus. Now understand that this horizontal fissure does not divide cerebellum into any lobes. Here, after culmen and quadrangular lobule, the quadrangular lobule is on both sides, ala is on both sides, simple lobule, superior semilunar lobule, inferior semilunar lobule, biventral lobule, tonsil. So they are there on both the sides, and in between is the vermis, and vermis is also divided into many parts. Now, here is a fissure called as fissura prima. Fissura prima. And here is a fissure called as posterolateral fissure. Posterolateral fissure. So anterior to fissura prima is the is the anterior lobe. Okay. Then is the middle lobe. This whole thing is middle lobe. And then this is the flocculonodular lobe. So there are three lobes. Three lobes. So now I'll draw a red line over here. That is fissura prima. So anterior to this fissura prima is anterior lobe. So this whole is anterior lobe. Then this whole thing is middle lobe, and this is flocculonodular lobe. This is nodule and this is flocculus. So totally there are each hemisphere of the cerebellum shows three lobes, anterior lobe, middle lobe, and the flocculonodular lobe. Flocculonodular lobe. So these are the three lobes present in the cerebellum. Now that is the anatomical classification of cerebellum. That what we spoke about is the anatomical classification of cerebellum. Now, we want to talk about the functional classification of cerebellum. The functional classification of cerebellum is archicerebellum. Archicerebellum. Or also called as vestibulocerebellum. Archicerebellum, also called as vestibulocerebellum. Now, what parts does it include? It includes lingula, flocculus, and nodule. So I'm marking it all with red. So lingula plus floccule plus nodule, or lingula plus nodule plus floculus. So lingula plus nodule plus floculus. So together, three of them form archicerebellum or vestibulocerebellum, which is concerned with balance. So that is one of the functions of cerebellum. The next part is paleocerebellum. So let me write it with green. Paleocerebellum. Or spinocerebellum. So this paleocerebellum or spinocerebellum will include this part, whatever I'm drawing in green. So it includes anterior lobe minus lingula. So in anterior lobe minus lingula, because lingula is part of archicerebellum, plus pyramid and eula of middle lobe. So that is paleocerebellum. Function of this paleocerebellum is tone and posture. So archicerebellum is lingula plus floculonodular lobe, concerned with balance. Paleocerebellum is anterior lobe, which is anterior to fissura prima. Anterior lobe minus lingula, because lingula is already used for floculonodular lobe. And pyramid and eula of the middle lobe. So this anterior lobe minus lingula and pyramid and eula of the middle lobe together form paleocerebellum or spinocerebellum. Then what is neocerebellum? Now let me draw it with another ink. Neocerebellum. Now neocerebellum, also called as pontocerebellum, it includes middle lobe. But in the middle lobe, we know that pyramid and eula is already used up for the paleocerebellum. So we say middle lobe minus pyramid and eula. So pyramid and eula is not there. Minus pyramid and eula. And the function of pontocerebellum is fine movements. Coordination of the fine movements of the body. Okay. So cerebellum has three parts. Archicerebellum, which includes lingula and floculonodular lobe, concerned with balance. Paleocerebellum, which contains anterior lobe minus lingula and pyramid and eula of middle lobe, concerned with tone and posture. And neocerebellum, which consists of this entire middle lobe, but excluding pyramid and eula, because that is used for paleocerebellum. And that is concerned with fine movements. So this is about the parts of the cerebellum. Now, we will talk about the cerebellar peduncle. The cerebellar peduncles are three in number. Let us start with their names are very simple. Inferior peduncle, superior middle peduncle, and superior peduncle. To remember it very easily, the inferior peduncle connects it mainly to the medulla and spinal cord. Middle peduncle connects it with pons, and superior peduncle connects it with midbrain and structures above it. So now we are talking about inferior cerebellar peduncle. Now, whenever we talk about each peduncle, we are going to talk about what afferent fibers reach the cerebellum through this peduncle. and what are the efferent fibers. So amongst the afferent fibers, mainly posterior spinocerebellar fibers. This is the main fibers, posterior spinocerebellar fibers. They come from the spinal cord, okay, and they are mainly for the hind limb area. They carry the proprioception of the hind limb area. Then, so this was one. Then the next is cuneocerebellar fibers. So this was for the hind limb. Then is cuneocerebellar fibers. These cuneocerebellar fibers, they are carrying the fibers of the forelimb. Okay, they are carrying the fibers of the forelimb. They end in the accessory cuneate area. Then is oligocerebellar fibers. Okay, they come from the inferior olivary nucleus of the medulla. Oligocerebellar fibers. They constitute fibers which are called as climbing fibers, which are called as climbing fibers of cerebellum. Okay. Then there are other fibers called as parolivo. Then there are fibers called as reticulocerebellar. Okay. Then there are fibers called as vestibulocerebellar. Vestibulocerebellar, they come from the vestibular nerve. Then there are anterior external arcuate fibers. Now this, if you can remember, that is fine. Then there are fibers like stria medullaris. They come from the arcuate nucleus. And then there are trigeminocerebellar fibers. Now I'll tell you the technique. When I talk about the efferent, I'll tell you the technique of how to remember all of this. Efferent, you have to just remember V O R. Cerebellovestibular. Cerebellolivary, cerebelloreticular. So same thing is here. See here, V O R. So V O R, and you have to remember most important posterior spinocerebellar. The posterior spinocerebellar fibers plus POR, vestibulocerebellar, oligocerebellar, reticulocerebellar, and in efferent is cerebellovestibular, cerebellolivary, cerebelloreticular. So vestibular, olivary, reticular. These are the main afferent and efferent. So in the afferent also you find them POR. Okay, there they are afferent fibers are called vestibulocerebellar, reticulocerebellar, oligocerebellar. Efferent are called as cerebellovestibular, cerebellolivary. Okay. Then we'll talk about the next, that is middle cerebellar peduncle. This middle cerebellar peduncle, it has only afferent fibers. Only afferent fibers. Okay, and they come from the cerebrum. Okay, they cross to the opposite side and they end in the neocerebellum. Okay, so they are they come from cerebrum, end in the pontine nucleus. Okay, there are nucleus in the pons. Okay. And then they cross over, and they end in the neocerebellum area. Neocerebellum is middle lobe minus lingula, and middle cerebellum is middle minus pyramid and eula. Middle lobe minus pyramid and eula. So they end in the neocerebellum. Okay. Then the third is superior cerebellar peduncle. So we saw inferior cerebellar peduncle, where our mnemonic was OR, POR, vestibular olivary reticular. Then we saw middle cerebellar peduncle, which has only afferent fibers coming from cerebrum and ending in pontine nucleus, crossing over, going to neocerebellum. Then superior cerebellar peduncle. Superior cerebellar peduncle also has afferent fibers, which now posterior spinocerebellar was here. So anterior spinocerebellar fibers, anterior spinocerebellar fibers, okay, and afferent is tectocerebellar fibers. So what are the efferent fibers? These tectocerebellar fibers, they come from the superior and inferior follicles. Superior and inferior follicles of the midbrain. Now, amongst the efferent fibers, there are fibers going from fastigial nucleus to the reticular formation of midbrain, pons, medulla. The fastigio-reticular fibers. Then there are fibers going to the inferior olivary nucleus. Then there are cerebellorubral fibers. Okay. They go to the red nucleus. They go to the red nucleus of midbrain. Then there are dentatothalamic fibers. They go from dentate nucleus to thalamus. So basically, inside the cerebellum, if you take a cross section, there are the gray matter is here, and then is white matter. But inside the gray matter, there are four nuclei. The largest is on the lateral side, which is called as dentate. Okay. So there is fastigial. Then there is lobos. Then there is emboliformis. And then there is dentate. How do we remember it? Fat, girls, eat donuts. Okay. So fastigial, globose, emboliformis, and dentate. Fat girls eat donut. Fastigial, globose, emboliformis, and dentate. Amongst this, fastigial is a part of archicerebellum. Globose emboliformis is a part of paleocerebellum, and dentate is a part of neocerebellum. So here, where I have listed, I said archicerebellum includes the lingula and flocculonodular lobe. So here I will include plus fastigial nucleus. When I wrote about spinocerebellum, I said anterior lobe minus lingula plus pyramid and eula of middle lobe. And here I will write plus the globose and emboliformis nucleus. Globose and emboliformis nucleus. And in the neocerebellum, I have written it includes middle lobe minus pyramid and eula. And here I will add and dentate nucleus. So dentate nucleus is part of neocerebellum. So we have studied the three cerebellar peduncles, inferior, where the mnemonic was war, cerebellovestibular, cerebellooliary, cerebellorreticular, reticulovestibular, reticulooliary, reticulo. So basically, in the afferents, they are vestibulocerebellar, olivocerebellar, reticulocerebellar, and the efferents, it is cerebellovestibular, cerebellooliary, and cerebelloreticular. Middle are only cerebropontocerebellar fibers. Superior cerebellar peduncle has anterior spinocerebellar because posterior spinocerebellar go in the inferior peduncle. Then there is tectocerebellar, and amongst the efferent are fastidioreticular, cerebellorubral, dentatothalamic fibers. Now we come to the connections of cerebellum. Intracerebellar connections. Okay. We are talking about the intracerebellar connection. The cerebral cortex, cerebellar cortex, has three layers. And in the middle layer are huge cells called as Purkinje cells. So these cells are called as Purkinje cells. And in outer layer is called as outer molecular layer. Outer molecular layer, which has cells called as basket cells. Okay. Then here, so molecular layer is outermost, second is Purkinje cell layer, and third is granular layer. The cerebellar cortex has three layers: molecular layer, Purkinje cell layer, and granular. So this is molecular layer, this is Purkinje cell layer. So layer number two is this, one is molecular, two is this, and three is granule cell. In the granule cell layer, we find granule cells. These granule cells have a short dendrite, and their axons, they go into the molecular layer and form parallel fibers. Now let us talk about the input of cerebellum. But before that, I would like to tell you that Purkinje cell dendrites, they go into the molecular layer, and axons of the granule cells, they are also there in the molecular layer. Now we talk about the cerebellar input. Cerebellar input is by one set of fibers which come from the inferior olivary nucleus, and they are called as mossy they are called as climbing fibers. So what are the climbing fibers? They come from inferior olivary nucleus, and they enter and they go up directly into the molecular layer, and they climb over the dendrites of the Purkinje cells. So these are climbing fibers. Right now, I'm only talking about cerebellar cortex, which has three layers: outer molecular, middle Purkinje, inner granular. And granular cells, they send their dendrites here, and axons are forming parallel fibers in the molecular. All the remaining fibers, apart from fibers coming from inferior olivary nucleus, are called as mossy fibers. So these mossy fibers, they enter the granule cell layer, where there are granule cells. Then there are Golgi cells. These Golgi cells, axons, they come here. Golgi cells, axons, they come here. Its dendrites go up. So dendrite of the granule, then all mossy fibers. Mossy fibers is all other things passing through the peduncle except for the oligocerebellar fibers. Oligocerebellar fibers are called climbing fibers. Remaining all what we saw in the superior, middle and inferior peduncle, remaining all fibers are called mossy fibers. These mossy fibers, they form glomerulus. They form glomerulus. Glomerulus is union of axon of Golgi, dendrite of granule and the mossy fiber. So this is about the cerebellar cortex. In the medulla, we find these four nuclei. Okay, so this was the input of the cerebellum is climbing fibers, mossy fibers. Now here we find the four nuclei. So the Purkinje cell axons, they end in these four nuclei. They end in this four nuclei. And the fibers arising from these four nuclei, they constitute the cerebellar output. They consider the constitute the cerebellar output. So these nuclei, they lie in the medulla, four nuclei, vestigial, globose, emboliformis, and dentate. Fibers arising from these nuclei constitute the cerebellar output. Cerebellar input is climbing fibers coming from inferior olivary nucleus. Remaining all fibers are called mossy. Climbing go above the Purkinje dendrites. Mossy, they go to the molecular granular layer where they anastomose with dendrite of granule and axon of Golgi. So this is intracerebellar connection. At least you should remember, input is via climbing and mossy fibers and output is via the axons arising from the cerebellar nuclei. Now coming to the last part of the cerebellum, and that is the dysfunction. The mainly we'll firstly talk about the functions of cerebellum. So functions of cerebellum are very now easy to remember. It's the archicerebellum, which is important for maintenance of equilibrium. The paleocerebellum, which is for the tone of voluntary muscle and posture. Okay. And neocerebellum is for coordination. Coordination of the movements. For the coordination of the movements. So this is about the function. Now, what will happen in case there is a cerebellar dysfunction? So let us discuss cerebellar dysfunction. So in cerebellar dysfunction, what is mainly going to happen is, we said these are the functions. Equilibrium, right? So what will happen in dysfunction? In dysfunction, there will be disequilibrium. Disequilibrium. We said tone is the function of cerebellum. So there will be hypotony. Posture is the function. So if there is a dysfunction, what is going to happen is there is instability of the posture, instability of joints. Okay, and coordination is the function. So there will be muscular incoordination. So if this equilibrium is function, there will be disequilibrium. If tone and posture is the function, there will be hypotonia and instability. If coordination is the function, muscular incoordination will happen in cerebellar dysfunction. Now let us go into further details of cerebellar dysfunction. How do you remember this? D is decomposition of complex movements. D decomposition of complex movements into simple. We will not be able to perform complex movement. Everything will be done in a simple way. D. Dysdiadokinesis. Dysdiadokinesis. Inability to perform alternate movement. So no rapid alternate movements. Okay. So tell the patient to do like this, like this, like this, like this. Kachapapad, pakapapad. We will not be able to do. That is called as dysdiadokinesis. The next D is dyspepsia. Okay. So no control over range of movement. No control over range of movement. The next thing, defective speech. Speech is also a very coordinated activity. So spinocerebellum is gone. So the person goes, speaks in a way called as scanning speech. So I will be speaking like this. Scanning speech. Okay. Then next thing, defect in gait. This is called as a staggering gait. Cerebellar gait is called as staggering gait. The person walks with broad movements. So normally we walk like this. So staggering gait is like this. Like this a person will walk. Staggering gait. Then there is fast pointing text. This cannot point, cannot point in a particular direction. Okay. Then there will be cerebellar tremors. And then lastly, P, so D, PTN, cerebellar nystagmus. So the eyes will move to and fro. So cerebellar nystagmus. So these are the so easiest thing. How do you remember cerebellar dysfunctions? It causes equilibrium. So there will be disequilibrium. It controls tone. So there will be hypotonia. It controls posture. So there will be instability of joints. It causes coordination of movement, so there will be muscular incoordination. This is minimum thing you should write. And then if you want to write in details, decomposition of complex movement into simple, that is 1D. Second D is dysdiadokinesis, not able to perform rapid alternative movement, dysmetria, loss of control over range of movement, D, defective speech, so there is scanning speech, D, defective gait, so there will be staggering gait. Then there will be fast pointing, cannot point, fast pointing test, cannot point in particular direction. You tell the person to point the finger like this, will not be able to point. Then there will be cerebellar tremors. Okay, so T is for tremors, PTN, and N is for cerebellar nystagmus. So with that, I end my session on cerebellum. Thank you so much.